Now Janssens pushes the puck deep. He's on a breakaway. Jonathan Janssens backhand scores! Here's Johnny! And just like that, it's 1-1. Backhand pass back to Bergqvist. Shot. Murphy the save. Rebound settled down by Howell. Over to Morella. Scores! Here's Serpa to Fishman. Reel in another. Stepien. In for McDonald. Over to Pennelly. Oh, Nelly! It's another for Pennelly. And Vlad will get out this time. Patisian catching up for a 2-on-1. Vlad shoots. Scores! Who's your Vladdy? And the Rangers have a 1-0 lead.
The voice behind the blue shirts, Kitchener Rangers radio play-by-play voice Mike Farwell, joins us on another edition of OHL Voices. Mike calls the action on 570 News Kitchener, hosts the Mike Farwell Show, and also joins broadcast partner Chris Pope on the Farwell and Pope podcast, bringing you all things Rangers while also taking a big-picture look across the Ontario Hockey League. Mike, thanks for being on.
Josh, you're giving me pains in my heart thinking about all of those hockey-related things while we still wait for the season to start. But it's great to get a chance to talk a little bit of hockey with you here, so thanks for having me.
Yeah, believe me, I feel your pain. you've got over 20 years of broadcast experience. I know I heard you back in the day on the Fan 590. You've been in the booth calling Rangers games since around 2007, I think, and maybe you can tell us a little bit about your journey. Of course, perhaps a word on the tremendous influence of Rangers broadcasting legend Don Cameron on your career.
Yeah, you know, you bring up that name, and it actually, Josh, takes me right back to the very beginning. When I started out working in radio, which is, oh my gosh, too long ago. Let's just go with, 20 plus some years. But I was working at a music station out in British Columbia, and I had in my mind at the time, I'm either going to be the next John Derringer on Q107, or I'm going to be the next Bob Cole on Hockey Night in Canada. So I'm trying to find my way as this young broadcaster. And I wrote Don Cameron a letter, and I said to him, listen, here's my situation. I'd like to someday do what you do. How do I get there from where I am in this little place called Salmon Arm, British Columbia? And, I'll never forget, Don took the time to write me back, essentially a young kid that was saying, I'd like to do your job someday. But that just goes to show the kind of gentleman that he was. And he had an influence on me since those very, very early days. And what a thrill it was for me to end up being in the booth with him on a full-time basis. I had filled in on a couple of games in the years leading up to joining him on a full-time basis for every game. And I could go on and on this entire segment just talking about Don Cameron and his influence on me and his influence on the game. But he certainly left an imprint since my very early days in all of.
Yeah, we certainly all have those people who have kind of helped us along the way. And I know Don, he's played a big role in your life and career. And definitely, as you said, a gentleman that would always go out of his way to have a conversation and say hi. I know I had a few run-ins with him, just a few chats about hockey back in the day, and always appreciated his time. One cause I know that's something you care a great deal about is the Farwell for Hire Fund. Maybe tell us a little bit about that initiative, how it came about, and a few of your experiences out on the job raising money for cystic fibrosis research.
Yeah, it's a campaign that I started 7 years ago now. It was May of 2014. May annually is Cystic Fibrosis Awareness Month, and that is a cause that's very near and dear to my heart, because I lost a couple of sisters to that disease many years ago, and I do this fundraising campaign now every year in their memory. And with May being Cystic Fibrosis Awareness Month, that's why I run the campaign when I do. And essentially, I go out and hire myself out for any and all odd jobs in order to raise money. I accept a donation as my payment, if you will, for doing that odd job. And it's been great. I joke all the time that I've been building my resume. So when they boot me out of the broadcast booth, I've got experience doing all kinds of things from, washing cars and painting sheds to making veal in a butcher shop or serving ice cream at the DQ. So I've really run the gamut when it comes to the things that I've done. Some things I try to forget with farm animals, but people have had some fun at my expense with that, bringing the city onto their properties to learn a little thing or two about farming and whatnot. And it's been great. It's been really well received. I've had huge support from my colleagues in Guelph. And think about that, as the Rangers broadcaster with the Highway 7 Rivals. But Steve Fitzsimmons and Bill Granger have been great to me. Trevor Pryor as well on the broadcast team there have been just super, as well as Larry Malott on the radio side. But so they've had me on and doing little things, and they make donations to my campaign every year. And it speaks to the fraternity and the community of the OHL really is too.
Yeah, a friendly rivalry. I can only imagine.
Absolutely, yeah.
The skills you've picked up doing a few of those things over the years, that's great. Getting to call the action from the odd, which in my personal opinion is possibly the best rank in the league, has to be a thrill for you. You know, a consistently competitive franchise in Kitchener. Can you share a few of your favorite memories from your time in the booth over the years?
Yeah, you hit the nail on the head when you talk about the building and the history that's attached to it. And imagine then being a kid that was born and raised in Kitchener and used to go to the games with his dad to watch Brian Bellows and Jeff Larmer and Al McInnes and Mike Torkey, one of my all-time favorites a little later on, well after dependable Wendell Young. But anyway, not to get into all of that history. But as a kid, this building is massive. It's long been referred to as kind of a Maple Leaf Gardens type rink in the Ontario Hockey League. So to get the chance then to go in and call games, and you don't need a ticket, the ushers just let you walk on by, and you get to go into all the little back corridors that you never got to see as a kid. It is still to this day an absolute thrill for me. And the highlight along the way, among them anyway, have to be the 2007-2008 season, the last that Pete DeBoer was in Kitchener, obviously, and it was the year that the Rangers hosted the Memorial Cup. The mission that year was to go in through the front door, and the Rangers did, barely, in the OHL final, a 3-0 lead on the Belleville Bulls, and it's looking like Kitchener might run through the OHL playoffs with the best ever mark of 16-1. They were 15-1 after going up 3-0 on the Bulls that year. But then the Bulls, as you well know, Josh, come roaring back with 3 straight wins, and it forces a game 7. The Rangers would win that, win the OHL championship, and then, of course, lose the final to Spokane, but made it to that Memorial Cup final game while they were hosting. And that experience in the city, of course, being the home broadcaster for the Rangers, but then the entire city for those 10 days of the tournament being here and the eyes of the junior hockey world on the city of Kitchener was something that I'll never forget. Not to mention, dare I say, we haven't gotten that loud. We haven't heard it that loud inside the Memorial Auditorium since then. There have been some great games and some great memories, but that one and that season will always stand out for sure.
The 2019-20 season was a rather interesting one in Rangerland. The team, some might say, exceeded expectations in 2018-19 following, you know, what was some heavy graduation after making the trip to Game 7 of the West Final the year prior. You had a lot of offensive firepower coming back to the lineup this past season, but not the start that it was hoped for, led to a coaching change. And then GM Mike McKenzie steps behind the bench. Maybe you can take it from there on how things unfolded.
Yeah, it's funny. GM Mike McKenzie steps behind the bench, and at the same time, goaltender Jacob Ingham stepped back into the crease. It was a game in Erie. The Rangers won it in, I'm pretty sure it was a shootout. It was definitely extra time, but it was close, and they had been, you're right, it wasn't the start the team had really been looking for. And then, of course, they went on an absolute heater and won 23 of Mike's first 25 or something like that. It's funny, when I think back on things like this, and we already talked about Don Cameron, he would recount for you, I guarantee, every single game and the final score and the winning goal scorer of the Rangers' 25-game CHL record run. My memory doesn't work quite as well as his does. We're talking about just the most recent season, but it was a great run under Mike McKenzie. It did coincide with Jacob Ingham's return, who for my money is one of the best we've seen. And there've been a lot in Rangers goaltending, obviously, over the years. I already mentioned Wendell Young and Mike Torkia, John Gibson. And, you know, you put Jacob Ingham right up there in those same breaths with some of the best that they've seen in this building. And it was a great run. And I joke because the Rangers then went on their search for a new head coach, and not too long later they announced that it was going to be Mike McKenzie. And I've always joked that, you know, Mike, after an extensive search, got up behind a podium and said, yeah, we've looked around and I've decided to hire myself to be the head coach of the Kitchener Rangers. But you can't argue with the success that he had, with the culture that he was able to continue in Kitchener. And you look back now on that season when it ended, the way the Rangers had been going, and it's got to be one of those teams. Ottawa, you're obviously going to ask those questions about or have that same question, but it's the big what if now. Was this a a special year? Was there something in the water here in Kitchener that would have made it a real memorable run? But what they got out of the regular season up until it ended was a pretty special season.
Yeah, you mentioned Jacob Ingham, of course, is someone who, you know, pursues humanitarian endeavors off the ice. I'm sure you can appreciate Jacob's work as the OHL's Humanitarian of the Year this past year. That move that General Manager Mike McKenzie made last summer to acquire him from the Mississauga Steelheads, when you look at all the moves throughout last season, I mean, that might be the biggest game changer, not only on the ice for the Rangers, but also off the ice.
Yeah, it really was. And I think when you look at the way it's kind of the calling card of Mike McKenzie right now. He likes to do his dealing in the off season. And if you had considered what he ended up trading draft picks to get Jacob Ingham in the summertime, what it would have cost him by a trade deadline. It makes him look like an absolute genius, certainly in that case, but that's kind of the way he seems to like to do things. Jacob was absolutely a key part of that run for the Rangers last year. And you talk about his humanitarian efforts off the ice. I'm continually amazed. And obviously the league has a humanitarian of the year every year. We've seen McFadden's movement out of Guelph is another recent example, but these young men doing what they do at the stage of life they're at, I can tell you, Josh, what I was thinking about when I was 18 years old, and it wasn't fundraising. It wasn't a Hockey Gives Blood campaign. So I think it's damned impressive to see these young men get involved in their communities the way that they do. And yes, Jacob recognized as the Humanitarian of the Year in the league this year, but you pick any OHL city and any OHL team, and you're going to find a player or players involved in something in that community. And I think it's great to see them use the platform the way that they do and to be encouraged to use that platform the way that they can.
It's probable that the Rangers will lose each of their top four scorers to graduation, you know, given Damiani's entry-level deal with Dallas, and then the other three guys were overagers and Howell, Morales, and Yancis. But, you know, in some of the conversations I have, I sense some optimism just around Kitchener that some of that offense can be recovered just based off some of the exciting young guys coming up through the depth chart there.
Yeah, you've got a guy like Francesco Pinelli who came into the league like a house on fire and was scoring at a pretty rapid rate, looking at, like, you know, this OHL thing, it's pretty easy. He tailed off as the season went on, as many rookies tend to do. But that's, you know, one of the younger pieces of this. Reed Vlad's a guy that I've had time for since he came into the league, and he was probably among the most snake-bitten I've ever seen coming in as a first-rounder, and he couldn't buy one. I bet you he hit more posts and crossbars than he scored goals. He finished his rookie season with 5. He deserved way more. He definitely found that in his sophomore season. And he's a guy that I look at as being one that will be a real key contributor offensively. Mike Batesian is another name that comes to mind. Never cheats you on a shift, is a real tenacious, hard worker. So, yeah, to your point, and I think fans in Kitchener get kind of excited and enthused by what they saw the Rangers do in 2019-20, the way it started, the way it turned around, and even the season prior where you mentioned it was kind of one of those where it was expected to be a bigger step back than it turned out to be. So I think there's a real belief here that there's, you know, there's something that's been created that is continuing to churn out a competitive product the way they play the game night in and night out. And if I'm a Rangers fan, I'm looking at the seasons plural ahead, the way the draft is shaped up and with the players they've got on the ice, that when it is time for that little bit of a reset that every team goes through, it's not going to be a long time back to at or near the top, and it's certainly not going to be a steep or a precipitous drop.
Just dropping back to the blue line, and when you look at what the Rangers are bringing back, you have to feel pretty good about their experience and their physicality. I mean, Vukojevic, Jack Eye, and Sabrango, all guys you don't really want to go into the corner with. And, of course, Ottavainen and Motu, they both showed some promise.
Yeah, I've always, from the moment I saw him, enjoyed watching Simon Motu skate, and he's going to be a real special player on the back end in this league. You mentioned Donovan Sabrango, and he's a kid that I've always described as sneaky tough. If I'm going into a dark alley sometime, I'm taking Donovan with me because nobody's going to suspect anything, and then they're going to try to make a wrong move on us, and Donovan's going to show them who's boss. That kid is tough as a $3 schnitzel, as far as I'm concerned. And I think he's going to make an NHL team real happy in October when the draft rolls around. And then Vukojevic goes without saying, he's a freaking man-child is what he is. I remember when he came in partway through that I guess it would have been the 17-18 season when the Rangers had the nice run to the Western Conference final against Sault Ste. Marie. But he came in partway through after being lured out of the United States. And just the minute you saw him, you thought, how is this kid 16? Like, it just doesn't add up. And then you see him put that that frame and that size with the mobility he still had on the ice, which was great. And I leave Arbor Jack Eye for last deliberately just to say a little bit more, because here's a guy that has truly just earned his place. He came in as a free agent and just found a way. And to be brutally honest, and Arbor would kind of chuckle at it too, I'm sure. The first games I saw him, I thought, boy, this is a project that might not make it out of training camp. He just didn't seem to have what it took, but they kept him on. And this guy has worked his way up into what I would call a real critical role on the Rangers' back end. Will be a shutdown guy. And yeah, you want to talk about a guy you don't want to go into the corners with. Arbor Jack Eye, the sheriff, as he's known around these parts in Kitchener, will make you pay for your transgressions. And he's gotten smarter and smarter as the years have come on. So I really admire what he's put in to earn his spot and then keep it on the Rangers' back end.
Aside from reestablishing themselves in the crease post-Jacob Ingham, one of the biggest changes in the Rangers organization is, of course, adapting to the addition of a new chief operating officer in Joe Birch, who is replacing the recently retired Steve Bienkowski. He held down the position since 2002. Birch and Bienkowski, both former Rangers. I had the pleasure of working with Joe at the league office for the past 6 years, but I'm sure Steve's a guy who will be missed around the community there.
Boy, oh boy. You know, as you were mentioning those names, Josh, I was thinking back to the earlier part of our conversation about Don Cameron and how long I could go on and extol the virtues of somebody that's been so important to, you know, Don Cameron, obviously, as a broadcaster to the entire league. But you'd say the same thing, I think you would, about Steve Bienkowski and his 18 years at the helm of the Kitchener Rangers as chief operating officer and in this community. A member of our Sports Hall of Fame here in the region of Waterloo, and a guy that just gets it. He recognizes the rather unique nature of the Kitchener Rangers being a community-owned club, but he puts that U in community and ensures that the team is involved, the players are involved by extension, and as much as he's going to deliberately kind of put himself in the background, his fingerprints are all over the way this team conducts its business in the community and the role that it has. And then on the other side of it is his business sense. And I'll be perfectly honest with you, when I first met Steve Bienkowski, and I've told him this to his face, he scared the hell out of me. Like he just commands a room, and he's so damn smart that you're like, I don't even belong in the same room as this guy. But once you get to know him and you see that sense of humor, especially, it's pretty easy to warm up to the guy. And Joe Birch has got big shoes to fill. I have no doubt that he can fill them, and you know that better than most. But he's leaving, Steve Bienkowski is leaving quite the legacy here with the Kitchener Rangers organization.
Yeah, having worked with Joe, I know he's a great fit, and he'll be awesome in Kitchener, a really enthusiastic and positive guy who gets right down to work and get things done. So we're in the opening week of September. I'm sure it's a little strange for a guy like you not being at the odd and getting into that preseason rhythm. The goal, obviously, is to drop the puck on December 1st. How are you going to be spending a much quieter fall?
Oh, man. I got to be honest. It sucks. It's been 20 years of every Friday night come September, you know. But I've made a commitment to the family. We were joking about a month ago. I said, you know, the season opener, the home opener for the Rangers would have been September the 25th. We would have been doing some preseason games. Obviously, we get the rink by now. It's training camp time. So I said, let's just every Friday night until December, let's do something. Because how many times, and people that have been in this league for longer than I have or as long, know what it's like when you've got, you know, friends that want to do this. They, hey, come on over, let's do that on a weekend. And you're like, no, sorry, it's hockey season. 7 months of the year, you're kind of blocked off. So as weird as it is, we're going to try to make the most of it and do a bunch of things that we haven't been able to do in decades on our weekends in the fall. So if there's a bright side to it, look, talk to me again in early November and see if the family's sick of me. But hopefully we get some quality time together and with friends over the next few months.
Yeah, I could totally relate with two little guys at home. I'm sure my wife will appreciate the extra help. So I'll do my best. But like you said, come November, I might really be itching to get back to it. Nice to chat today, Mike. I look forward to seeing you around the rink again soon. And enjoy the time.
I really will. And thanks very much for giving me this time to at least talk a little bit of hockey at this time of year, because we're so used to doing that. And I can't wait to get back at her. It's a great league, and I'm thrilled to still be working in it.
Thanks, Mike. We'll talk to you later.